verses 1 through 7. 2 Kings in the 6th chapter, verses 1 through 7. Starting in the first verse, and it says, "And the sons of the prophets said unto Elisha, Behold, now the place where we dwell with thee is too strait for us. Let us go, we pray thee, into Jordan, and take this every man a being, and let us make us a place there where we may dwell. And he answered, Go ye. And one said, Be content, I pray thee, and go with thy servants. And he answered, I will go. So he went with them, and when they came to Jordan, they cut down wood. But as one was failing the beam, the axe head fell into the water, and he cried and said, Alas, my master, for it was borrowed. And the man of God said, Where fell it? And he shewed him the place, and he cut down a stick, and cast it thither, and the iron did swim. Therefore said he, Take it up to thee. And he put out his hand and took it. You may be seated. You know, as we look, and I used this just a couple of months ago, but it's still in the Bible. But we ask ourselves this, what does this have to do with Easter? I believe if you would take a deeper look, that we can see Jesus in every bit of these verses right here. Not only these verses, but every verse from Genesis in the first chapter to Revelation in the last chapter, the last verse. And as we look at it today, church, we must realize then that as we look, and I'll try to break it down as the Lord has shown me, that every man take a beam. Now every man, woman, boy, and girl in this life that has been born has a chance to take a beam. You say, what beam is that? The beam of salvation. The Bible teaches us that if we take up our cross and follow him. In today, church, as we look at this, we say, what are you trying to get at? I want us to look at, let's just start off with verse 5. But as one was fell in a beam, the axe head came into the water, and he cried and said, Alas, master, for it was borrowed. Now this just kind of reminds me right here of how we were before we came to the age of accountability. Now I don't know what age that is. No man or woman really knows what day that is. It just depends when that child begins to understand the difference between good and evil. And then they're held accountable. In today's church, there's a lot of people today that are going to be held accountable for the things done in this body. Now, you say, well, what's that got to do? Well, a child is innocent, a child is saved until they come to that age of accountability. And once they come to that age, they're separated, just as the axe head was separated from the handle. If we were separated from God. Now, as we look at that today, church, we got to ask ourselves, what did we lose when we were separated? Well, they lost the axe head, did they not? Mm-hmm. The axe head is the most important part of the axe. I mean, you can't cut down a tree with a handle. But I tell you what, with the axe head attached, firmly attached to the handle, you can cut down a tree, you can cut down a limb, you can cut down so many things and do so many things with the axe head. And today, church, I want us to look at this. I want us to look that we see that once a man or woman becomes that age of accountability, again, whatever age it is, they can't do anything without Jesus. Is that not true? I mean, think about it today, church. We're lost and we're undone because we no longer have that Holy Spirit dwelling in our life because we know the difference of good and evil. Now, what does that mean to us? That means we go to this world lost without the fellowship? Do you know why we feel empty inside? Do you know why we feel like there's something missing? Because when we was a child, we had the Holy Ghost living within our heart, leading us, guiding us, directing us in all truth and righteousness. But when we came to that age of accountability, unless we got saved that day, there's something missing, because the Holy Ghost cannot dwell in an unclean vessel.
That's right.
And so there's something missing. It had to leave us because of this unclean vessel. But as I look and I begin to see today, church, how this axe had left the handle, that it takes two parts, does it not? It takes an axe and it takes the handle. Now let me just slow down here a little bit today, church, that we don't want to be separated from God, do we?
No.
I mean, today, church, those that are separated from God, as Brother David already testified, they'll go to a place called hell with the devil. But today, church, the good news is, because of the death, the burial of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and because he did not stop there, but on that third day, upon that first Easter morning, he arose from the grave. Now, the stone was not rolled away for him to get out. The stone was rolled away that we could look in. And what did they see? We see that Peter and John looked inside and they saw a napkin folded and laid apart by itself. In other words, and you've heard this, if not, this might be new. But in Jewish tradition, if you enjoyed the meal that the host made for you, you would fold the napkin back in the way that you received it, signifying that you would do it again. Now, when they looked in and they found that napkin lay by itself, folded, they knew that Jesus would do it again, that he would come, that he would suffer, that he would die, that he would arise again for you and for me. But glory to God, once is sufficient. He'll never have to die on the cross again. Because once is sufficient. Now, as we look at this, that the handle and the axe head represents Jesus in us. I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. Is that not what the scripture tells us? It is. And as we look at this today, church, that we want to be able to go to heaven. Do we not? All of us want to. Everybody wants to go to heaven. But nobody wants to do what's required to get there. It's not the works. It's not the charity work. It's not the tithe. It's not the offering. These things are byproducts of salvation. But these alone can't get you into heaven. But what gets you into heaven is by accepting in your heart the finished works of Calvary and the resurrection. Now you say, well, that's a lot of terms, Brother Tony. What do you mean? That we accept Jesus? And the simplest prayer I ever prayed, now, I prayed a lot when I was a lost individual, but it didn't go no further than the roof of my mouth. But I did pray one prayer that got through, and that was when I was a sinner. And I realized that this was my last chance that God was going to deal with me. And then all I said was, Lord, I don't want to die and go to hell. I want to accept you into my heart. And that's it. That's all I did right there. And that took my name off the devil's roll and put it on God's roll. And do you know I got the best night's sleep I had in years, realizing that I didn't have to suffer the terror that awaited me. But now I can live with him forever with a glorified body likened unto the Son of God. Now, you say, is it really that simple? Yes, it is. The Bible teaches us that it's so simple that a wayfaring man nor a fool will err therein. Now, if a simple man can understand it like me, anybody can. But the Bible also teaches us that professing themselves wise, they became fools. It's harder for a rich man or a man of knowledge to accept the fact that somebody dies for them. See, the problem with this, and there's nothing wrong with having money, there's nothing wrong with having nice homes and cars, but put Jesus first. Get saved and put Jesus first. And then everything you have will be so much better. Amen. Even for a poor man, the little that you got will be better with Jesus in your life. See, today, church, it's not about what we have that gets us into heaven. The only what we have is Jesus. That's the only have we have to have. Right?
Yeah.
We're all guilty of a Walmart mentality. And what I'm simply saying is that if we want it, we go get it. Right? That's true. We're not like our grandparents and had to plant a crop or do this or do that, do the other thing. Back then, I remember when I first joined the Navy and I tried to get a Shell credit card. And they wouldn't give it to me because I didn't live in the same place for 3 years. And I wrote them back and I said, how in the world do you expect me to live in three places, live in one place for 3 years when I'm in the United States military? I said, I've already moved three times this year. And so they said, no. It's the same thing with the Sears card. Do y'all remember how hard it was to get a Sears card? If you got a Sears card, you were somebody then. But today, it's simple, is it not? All you have to do is sign your name, get a credit card, you want it, go buy it. Sometimes I think the simpler times where we relied on God more than we do now. You say, why is that? Because it's easy for us. Those old farmers didn't know whether it's going to rain or not. They prayed and they sought and they relied on God. And today, church, we need to have the mentality that whether it rains or shine, we're going to serve the Lord. Whether the crops come in or whether they don't, we're going to serve the Lord. No matter what happens, we're going to serve the Lord. Today, as we begin to look at this, and we see that there was a separation there. Now, he said, for it was borrowed. That's a whole different message, which I'll save for another time. But he said, show me. And the man of God said, whence fell it? In other words, where did it go? Show me where it went. And he said, just pretty well much over here, just went and flying off, and it just dropped right there. That's a place called Calvary. When we're separated from God, we need to go where it fell. What happened at Mount Calvary? Calvary, today, church, they took Jesus, and before this, they beat him beyond recognition. They made fun of him. They crowned him with a crown of thorns and put a robe of purple on him, mocked him, spit on him, slapped him, and beat him beyond recognition as a man. And then they forced him to carry that cross up the hill. And then when they got him there, they stretched his arms out. They put a nail in his wrist, in his hands. They put a nail in the other hand and threw both his feet. Then they hoisted him between heaven and earth and let that great big beam just jar in the bottom of that hole. According to history, that when this happened, a lot of joints in the body became out of place. And if you ever had an out of place joint, you know how much it hurts. And it hurt today, church. It hurt so much that God had to turn his back on his only begotten son on that day. And as I look at that, I can't separate Easter from the crucifixion. Right?
No.
Because without the crucifixion, there'd be no Easter.
That's right.
But yet, when the Lord turned his back, because he couldn't look what sinful man had done to his darling son, then we look and we see that Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." That's compassion and that's grace. Today, church, the Sadducees and Pharisees knew what they were doing. Religious folks knew what they were doing. But yet, Jesus looked and said, "Father, forgive them." I wonder today, church, have you ever accepted the forgiving power of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in your life? If you haven't, you need to. Your life can only get better. See, today, church, he looked and he said, he go up. And he gave up the ghost. In other words, his spirit left his body. And he died. Gave that last breath. And he was gone, naturally speaking. They took him. They pierced his side. Out came water and blood. And they knew he was dead. They took him off. They wrapped him in grave clothes. They put him in a barn tomb. He wasn't going to need it long. But on that third day, when Mary came and was going to anoint his body with spices, she saw the stone rolled away and the angel standing there. "Why seek ye the living among the dead?" Today, church, I would ask that question today too. Why are we seeking the living among the dead? The dead things of this world will never satisfy us. But Jesus is alive forevermore, and he can be alive in your heart. And if he is, let it shine. There's a song in the Red Book. It says, "Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so." Aren't you glad that Jesus loved you enough to die for you? He loved you enough to raise from the grave for you. He loved you enough to make salvation so simple that a wayfaring man or a fool can't wear therein. He loved you enough to sit on the right hand side of the Father, that when the devil comes and says, "This one, he made a mistake, he can't be yours. This one over here, oh, he just did this and he did that, he can't be saved." And oh, but the devil, he's been defeated. Jesus' Bible teaches us that during those 3 days, he went down to hell and preached to those in captive. And he took captivity captive. He took those that died in faith and took them with heaven with him. He took the keys of death, hell, and the grave from Satan. Whereas Satan's always before God the Father, accusing us before God, Jesus, as our advocate, stands right there, sits right there. It says, "His sins have been forgiven by my blood." That's the best news you could ever hear right there is my sins been forgiven. I remember before I got saved, I was miserable. Weren't you? Just miserable, lost, confused. Because I knew I was missing something, but I didn't know what. I looked at it, I told you this many a time. I looked at other religions. But they all left me empty. But that day that I accepted Christ as my Lord and Savior, something that made me whole again. And that was the Holy Spirit moved in my life. I realized that there was someone who loved me more than my wife, more than my family, more than my friends. And it was that love that has sustained me for over 20-something years. Over 25 years, I believe. And as I look at this, I realize that I'm glad that Brother Tibbs and the other men of God, the Willard Woods, the Steepletons, the JWs, and all these other men of God loved me. See, today, church, I didn't understand. I came from a family that didn't show love. I've shared that with you. You know, really they didn't start saying I love you until I was in my late 20s. But I found something in Jesus. I found something in these old men, these old saints of God. They'd tell Jackie and they'd say, tell Tony that we're praying for him. And I'd been wondering, why in the world were these old men worried about me? But they was worried about my soul. And they came and I got saved aboard ship and laying flat on my back in my rack. And that's all it took. Then I began to understand why those old men, why those brothers in Christ loved me so much. They saw that I needed Jesus. And as we go back and we look and we find that he cut down a stick and cast it thither, and the iron did swim. Therefore said he, take it up to thee. And he put out his hand and took it up. Salvation is such the simplest thing that you'll ever do. Today, church, that when we come to him, it didn't matter what I did. Morally, I was a good fellow. I didn't drink that much. I didn't do this. I didn't do that. But I still lost another one without God. And the point was that I picked him up. Actually, he picked me up. I just reached up. I'm like that little babe that reaches out his hands to his mother or father, say, pick me up. He picked me up, took me in his arms, and I'm glad to say I've been there ever since. You say, Brother Tony, don't you need to grow up? I grew up in maturing as a child of God. But as a mother looks at their children, or a father looks at their children, they're always their children. Mm-hmm. Manly's 26, she'll always be my little girl.
That's right.
And so as we look at that, I'll always be God's son. In today's church, if we just let go and let God.
That's right.
You know, as we go back and we look, and it's been a hard couple of years for a lot of us in here. Amen?
That's right.
Had a rough go. Yes. But through it all, because we accepted Christ as Lord and Savior, we have a friend.
Amen.
In Jesus. He sends us good friends, naturally speaking, too. But whereas they can't be there at midnight for you, Jesus can. In today, church, how is it with you? Do you know Jesus as Lord and Savior? Or have you grown cold and indifferent? God will take you back. You know, we're more interested in the things of this world. And there's things I'd like to do too. But I'm more interested in having Jesus right here. Aren't you?
That's right.
Today, church, as we see the swimming axe head, and there's a whole lot more to it. How the stick and the floating axe head, how it swam. Today, church, just let that stick real quick represent Calvary in the individual, that axe head. Come and let it be you swimming to the stick and be mounted up with Jesus.
Amen.
If you take a look, there's usually that much piece of wood sticking up out of the axe handle.
Mm-hmm.
The old ones anyway. Kind of looks like a cross.
Mm-hmm.
The cross and the resurrection go together. If you'll rise to your feet and give us a verse of a song, please. How is it with you today? I don't know what you stand in need of. Sometimes I don't even know what I stand in need of. I mean, I'm serious. Like I said, the last couple of weeks have been tough. I don't know what I need, but I know I need Jesus.
Amen.
What's your number, sisters?
Page 368.
Does anybody got a need? Maybe you're here, you're burdened down. Maybe you're here, you're troubled hearted. Could you come?